Only one in every million lobsters happen to be blue. And although that seems to be impressive, lobster, this one in a million lobster, felt more yucky than he did feel lucky. All the other sea creatures were not impressed with the color of his chest. Lobster was especially depressed, since he was not red like the rest. The other crustaceans made fun of him. They would not let him play gin or even synchronized swim. Miss Bristol and Quincy the Quahog were Blobster's best of friends. Miss Bristol cared for Blobster. She'd make him his favorite seaweed stew and tell ghost stories, too.
It was a dark and stormy night, and the evil man in the evil raincoat gave the poor lobster a terrible fright. He sprung on the lobster, dangled him over the pot, threatening him to go kaplop. Then the evil man in the especially evil raincoat, on the spot, threw the terrified lobster into the boiling pot. Oh, is that not correct, Quincy? Did you want to interject? What am I missing? Let's review the plot. We have an evil raincoat in a boiling pot. Oh, I didn't think you were so frail. Would you like to hear the one about the steamed lobster tail?
Quincy mumbled something, but he never really has much to say, and mostly mumbles since his wife, Miss Bristol, lives in his mouth all day and usually does most of the talking anyway.
Oh, lobster. Like I always say, whenever you're in danger, hide, because you're all different from the rest. No matter who you run into, remember you're blue, and someone would love to take a bite out of you.
One day, before anyone knew, a net too strong to swim through came from above and scooped up most of the crowd below, including Blobster by the toe. Miss Bristol was very frightened, and she watched as his tail swayed as her little lobster was carried away.
Oh, do be careful, Blobster. Remember, you're blue, and someone would love to take a bite out of you.
Quincy mumbled a safety warning, but it didn't matter what he had to say, because no one understands him anyway. All of the lobsters caught in the fisherman's knot, including Blobster, ended up on the boat in a horrible lot. Blobster wiggled himself free and looked for a place to flee. Blobster saw a blue ice chest and ran and stood next to it and tried his best to be camouflaged unlike the rest. With his new disguise, Blobster was able to stay alive. He climbed inside the ice chest, but little did he know, he had embarked on a new quest. Before he knew it, he was stuck. He was thrown onto a pickup truck, all alone going somewhere destination unknown. Once the truck had stopped, Blobster flopped onto the street. Before he could retreat, he'd stepped on the trail of a snobby, suspicious snail.
Yeah. Now, what are you? You don't look like a kangaroo, or a warthog, or even a polka-dotted bullfrog.
I am a lobster.
Yeah, whatever you are. You are not a lobster, Mr. Blobster. I happen to be an expert in aquatic affairs, and you, sir, are putting on airs. I went to junior college, and have extensive aquatic knowledge, and I do believe lobsters are rad. And you, sir, have been misled.
But I am a lobster, and I'm really off track. And I'm trying to find my way back to the sea, you see.
The snail glared and stared while Blobster despaired. And out of thin air came a pelican for a surprise attack. The snail hid in a crack, while Blobster, clueless, felt the entire impact. Before he could regroup, the pelican swooped and scooped him up, and now he was dangling from a beak, freaked that his future was becoming substantially bleak. He had no clue what to do, so he decided to make a plea and hope this will not be the end of me.
Well, Mr. Pelican?
The pelican ignored, and Blobster thought hard about how he could catch him off guard.
Mr. Pelican, I'm really trying to get back to the sea and would appreciate it if you were flying accordingly.
With no response from his feathered foe, he tried a different way to go.
I'm trying not to boast, but I have heard that pelicans have the most beautiful voices. I would give anything if only I could hear you sing.
The pelican, feeling especially proud,
started to sing quite loud. Lobster started to fall and didn't notice at all. Luckily, he landed in a pile of blueberry leaves that broke his fall instead of his knees. Lost and confused, Lobster tried to hide under a blueberry tree and did not see there was someone else there who started to flinch, because Blobster accidentally gave them a pinch.
Well, pardon me,
he said apologetically,
but you are the biggest blueberry I have ever seen.
The big blueberry looked at Blobster with her very beautiful blue eyes.
How do you do?
My name's Bertha, and you are very blue.
Oh, thank you. You are quite blue, too.
Very true. But I'm the bluest of blue. I'm so much bigger than the other blueberries that I just can't do what they do. They like to bounce around and play all day, but when I try to play, I always get in the way. Being big and blue and juicy too, people always want to take a bite out of me too.
Lobster loved her from the very first night and never wanted her out of his sight. He especially loved her great big juicy bubble. Well, you know, he fell in love, and whenever he saw her, he wanted to wrap his claws around her. Lobster and Bertha had lots of fun. Lobster impressed Bertha with his strength by tackling an inflatable shark and karate chopping tree bark. They decided to live in a lighthouse by the sea, where they could daily catch a wave or two and still play in the blueberry patch too. And they lived happily ever after. And Blobster didn't need to return to the sea, because their love was stronger than you and me, you see. In another time, their love would be a crime, only to be spotted together at lunchtime as a lobster roll next to a blueberry pie bowl. But their love is unique and part of the magical streak only possible during those golden days of summer.